Welcome back to the Forms for SharePoint video guide. In our previous videos, we have explored how to design the forms and how to connect SharePoint sites, lists, and libraries with the help of lookup control. If you haven't seen those videos yet, I have linked the playlist in the description. And in today's video, we're going to take a closer look at the list to library control. This control enables you to view, edit, add, or delete items or documents from related SharePoint lists and libraries inside the form. So let's start. In the previous video, we have already used list to library control to connect products. In our example, we have sports equipment in the child list linked to the categories in the parent list. And the parent list contains a variety of sports. So let's take a moment to revisit this process. To begin, we need to add a regular SharePoint lookup field to the list that we want to be displayed in the list to library control. This is merchandise child list containing fields with products, color, stock quantity, and price. So let's add a regular SharePoint lookup column. We'll name this column Sport Category. For the source list, we'll pick Sport Categories, Parent List, and choose Sport Column. Next, let's open Forms for SharePoint app. And here on the left, we need to refresh the SharePoint fields. And now we can drag and drop our new lookup field onto the form and save the form. We are back in our SharePoint list, and now we can add sport category per each item in the list. Let's select tennis racket, and we'll add tennis in the sport category column, and I'll fast forward the rest. Now that we have connected two lists with the lookup column, we can integrate list to library control into the sport categories parent list. We'll set it up to display all items from the merchandise child list associated with a specified category. To achieve this, let's go back to Forms for SharePoint app. I'll open a new tab and connect to the site and sport categories list. Next, I'll add additional panel in the accordion container. We'll name it available merchandise. And now we can drag and drop list library control. Click configure. And under data source, we will keep the same site URL, but you can choose any site within your tenant. In the list property, select merchandise child list. View and lookup field properties will pop up. In view, we'll keep the same all items. And in lookup field, we select the lookup column sport category. You also have the option to add the list library control to your form without specifying the lookup field. In this case, it will display all items from the source list without any filtration. Now we can save the form and go back to SharePoint. Let's click on soccer. And as you can see, products associated with soccer are now visible in the form thanks to list to library control. But what if you need to display items from a list that is located on a different site? Well, that can be done as well. For example, in the sport categories list, we may want to view the store locations where a particular sports equipment is available. Early in the video, when we were setting up list to library control, we added a regular SharePoint lookup column in the child list to associate merchandise with the sport categories. Given that both lists were located on the same site, adding a regular SharePoint lookup column worked. However, in this case, the store locations list lives on a different site, so a regular SharePoint lookup field will not work. Fortunately, Plumsail Forms for SharePoint offers a solution, the lookup control. We have looked closely at it in the previous video, so check it out. This control resembles the SharePoint lookup column. However, it allows you to link lists or libraries from different sites within one tenant. It stores its value in a regular multi-line text field, presenting and behaving as a lookup in both forms and list views. And let's navigate back to the Forms for SharePoint app and connect to Sports World HQ site and pick store locations list. Next, find lookup control and drag and drop it onto the form. Let's give it a name, sport categories. And now on the right-hand side, under data source, we'll link it to Sports World site, where the sport categories parent list is located. Choose sport as the display field. Next, save this control to a new field. We'll name it sport categories. We'll opt for multiple selection as the store will have merchandise related to more than just one sport. And remember to save the form. Now let's go back to the SharePoint list. And in the new column we created, I'll add the sport categories that can be found in each store. For example, in the downtown location, we can add football, skiing, running, cycling, swimming, and tennis. And I'll fast forward adding the rest of the sports. Let's go back to the Forms for SharePoint app. Here we're connected to the Sport Categories parent list. So let's add another panel in the accordion container and we'll call it Store Availability. Next, drag and drop List to Library control, click Configure, and in the data source we connect to Sports World HQ site, pick Store Locations list, and the lookup field will be Sport Categories, so that's the one we just created. So let's save the form and check if everything works in SharePoint. Click on Soccer. Great, now let's say if a store manager needs to locate certain product that is not available in his store, he can quickly reference this list and find which other locations carry this product. A fantastic feature of the List to Library control is the ability to edit items inside the form. So under the General Settings, under Editing, we have two options. First, let's select Inline Mode. It allows editing items without opening the form in the source list. So let's save the form and see how it works in SharePoint. Now let's click on Soccer, then click on Edit icon, and we can make changes right here in the form. Click Save, and the changes are saved both here and in the source list. So now let's look at the second editing option, Dialog. It launches a dialog window for creating new items or modifying existing ones. And let's see how it works in SharePoint as well. Click on Soccer and select the line item you would like to adjust, click Edit, and apply the changes. As you can see, both modes are quite convenient and you can choose either one according to your preferences. And now let's talk about column and list formatting. We're back in the merchandise child list, and as you can see, the color column is already formatted as a choice. And we can also customize the format view of the whole list. So under All Items, click Format Current View, and opt for Alternating Row Styles, then click Edit Row Styles, and select the colors you like. It's important to note that column and list formatting doesn't change the data inside list item or file. It changes how it's displayed for users browsing the list. Click Save, and now we return to the parent list. Let's open one of the items, and as you can see, the formatting is automatically displayed with the help of List to Library control. In addition to SharePoint formatting, you can apply custom column formatting to tailor how each column is displayed in the List to Library control. So let's open the Forms for SharePoint app and locate the List to Library control. The possibilities with custom formatting are virtually endless, and I have linked an article in the description with a few formatting examples for you to experiment with. Now let's explore one of the possible customizations. Imagine a scenario where a store manager would like to have a visual cue once the stock quantity of a product starts to get low. So we'll add color highlight to the stock quantity column that will depend on its value. First, let's select the column we'd like to customize. On the right-hand side, locate the template properties. The mode is currently set to default, and we need to switch it to custom. And now there is a field where you can paste the code snippet. Here I'll be using the code to dynamically change the background color based on the value of the number column. In row 1, I added our column name, stock quantity, and if you plan to use this in your list, ensure you use internal name of the column. Moving to row 5, I've specified that when the value is lower than 100, the cell background should turn red, and I specified the hex color code. For values between 100 and 200, the color will be yellow, and for anything above 200, the color will be light green. And by the way, there's no need to customize one column at a time. You can mix and match customizing multiple columns simultaneously by using code in the JavaScript editor and achieve the results for multiple columns at once. You can find the code in the article linked in the description as well. So let's save the form and see how it works in SharePoint. Let's click on Soccer and Available Merchandise. And here we have it. There are 150 pairs of soccer cleats and the number is highlighted in yellow. Goalkeeper gloves are at 62 count and highlighted in red. So let's change one of the values. For example, switch 150 to 200. Click Save. Great, now the number is light green, indicating that there is enough stock and there's no need to place a reorder yet. And now let's imagine that a store manager would like to have all products grouped by sport category along with a total count of stock quantity and total value of the goods. We can make this adjustment by editing the current view of the SharePoint list, and list library control supports both grouping and aggregation. So let's navigate to the merchandise child list and set this up. Click on all items and choose edit current view. Now scroll down to group by and select the sport category as the grouping column. We can customize additional properties such as order, ascending or descending, whether to collapse or expand the groupings, and how many to show per page. Now let's move on to totals. Specify the sum for both price and stock quantity columns. Click OK, and let's see how the grouping and aggregation appear in both child and parent list. After adding grouping, the merchandise child list looks more organized, offering a quick overview of the stock quantity and the total value of goods. Now let's go to the parent list. Click on one of the line items, and as you can see, with the help of list to library control, the products are grouped in the same way they are in the child list, displaying the sums of both stock and price. There's no need to change anything in the Forms for SharePoint app settings, as the list of library control picks up both grouping and aggregation automatically. And in the final part of this video, we'll go over how to filter by collaborative application markup language, or CAML. Filtering by CAML query is quite easy. First, you need to know how to use it and what it is exactly. You can read all about it in the article linked in the description. What you need to know is that CAML filtering is applied when you attach children items to parent. This is essentially the same filtering, but you can configure it to anything you like. If you already have filtering by lookup applied, you'll need to modify the query instead of replacing it. Otherwise, the filtration will be lost. In our example, in the parent list, in the store availability section, we can filter by property type. And now let's go back to the Forms for SharePoint app. We need to find drop-down under common fields and drag and drop it to the store availability section. Next, we'll rename it to property. And on the right-hand side in the data source, we'll add options lease and ownership. Click OK. Next, we'll add code in the JavaScript editor. You'll find several examples of filtering which can be copied and modified according to your needs in the article linked in the description. I am using one of those examples, and I have added our control name, list to library 2, and the drop-down field name, property. Let's save the form and check how it works in SharePoint. Click on skiing, and under store availability, we have property field where we can pick an option. For example, let's select lease, and as you can see, the items are filtered by that value. And you can set up this type of filtration by any field. Make sure to subscribe to not miss the future videos in the Forms for SharePoint guide series. We will explore advanced control, signature, data table, and Likert scale, and show how to create separate form sets for Microsoft 365 and SharePoint groups and more. If you have any questions or if you'd like us to cover a certain topic in the upcoming videos, please drop a comment below. And in the meantime, you can test out Forms for SharePoint with a free 30-day trial. Thank you for watching and see you soon.